All right, so this is principle of refrigeration, week 8, and we're still in the section of safety tools, equipment, and shop practices. We're trying to build some kind of skill set for how to handle refrigerants and tools when dealing with refrigeration equipment. And this week is unit 10, which is system charging. How do we charge a system, and some of the most common practices in charging a system. So we'll talk about set of objectives. We'll talk about refrigerant, how is refrigerant is charged into the system in the vapor or liquid state. So we can charge a system as vapor and also as liquid. If we try to analyze the storage cylinder, looks something like that. And if we try to imagine what's inside, it's pressurized refrigerant. So here it's at liquid state. And here it's at vapor. So we'll talk about why do we need to charge it in vapor or charge it in liquid. In liquid, it's faster because you're gonna put more with less time. And if you do it in vapor, it will take longer, but it requires less work. We'll talk about that. We'll set the advantage of using electronic scales for weighing refrigerant to the system. So refrigerant, I put it to the system using weight. It's not volume, it's not quantity. It's the only way we can know how much is in the system. But we'll describe the term temperature glide and fractionation as they apply to blended refrigerant. What are blended refrigerant called? It has a Z in it.
Azotropic.
So there's zeotropic or near azeotropic, and there's azeotropic. So this is what they mean by temperature glide. And basically, if you want to remember, what does that mean? It's just that two refrigerants put together and they have the same dew point and the same boiling point. We'll talk also about charge fixed orifice of capillary tube using charging charts and curves. So based on the chart, you can know how much to put in the system and which watch to use, the cold one or the liquid one. We'll also talk about subcooling methods for charging. So subcooling, that's the liquid line, right? The liquid is subcooled. The big line is the blue line. And it's called, it's vapor. And the small line is the liquid line, and it's liquid. And the subcooling happened in the liquid line. So if I sketch again the chart, the vapor dome that you like, we have here is subcooled liquid. Over here, superheated vapor. And so anything here is in liquid state, and everything here is in vapor state. And here is the mixture. So we have a mixture between vapor and liquid. So how do we use subcooling to charge the system? So basically that will go through the liquid line. Use subcooling method of charging to charge the air conditioning and heat pump system that incorporate thermostatic expansion valve as a metering device. So we can use our TXV as a thermostatic valve device. And we can use temperature pressure chart to help properly charge the air conditioning system. So we're using the temperature and pressure charge, we can know by the indication of the pressure of the line and the temperature that it corresponds to in the manifold and the measured temperature if the system is undercharged or overcharged. We'll differentiate between the bubble point and the dew point values on a temperature pressure chart and properly use those values to calculate superheat and subcooling values on the system that operates with blended refrigerant. We don't have to remember all the information for bubbling point. All you have to know is that the bubble point is when the refrigerant starts to boil at room temperature, or whatever temperature corresponds to the pressure. And the dew point is when you start to condensate. And where does the dew point happens? The condensation and the condenser, which is outside, and that's the hot part. And the cooling part happens in the evaporator, which is where the superheating happens, and that's in the cold section. That's the confusing part. So what we have here is the evaporator, and it's actually cooled. It's actually cold, and but superheating is happening over there. Outside is a condenser, and that's when we have subcooling, and cooling is happening to the refrigerant. So charging a system has to happen by adding refrigerant to the system if it's not performing properly due to a leak or due to change of equipment. You have to go and add in some refrigerant to the system. Before we add any refrigerant, we have to determine if there's a leak and fix that leak before we add some to it. And some large systems, they have allowable amount of refrigerant to be leaking during the year. So we add by weight, and that's the best way to do it. And when in doubt, pull everything out. So we go with a vacuum pump, evacuate the system, and we put everything in a recovery cylinder. So you cover the refrigerant, and you make sure that that cylinder is empty, and preferably under vacuum. So you vacuum all your air from the cylinder. Then you recover whatever refrigerant is in the cylinder. And what do? You put it back?
You can measure it.
The best practice is not to put it back, you put a new one. And you take that old refrigerant to the recycling or recovery. They will pay you for it, you get paid for it, and they take it and make sure there is nothing in it. No contamination whatsoever. So when in doubt, you take everything out and start new. Remember that. You can put it back again, but it's the best practice to take it out, do the fix, change the dryer and the dry filter, then put new product in. So adding by weight and measuring and using operating pressure. Never use a bathroom scale for the weight. Why? What do you think?
Pressure.
Huh? Is there a difference in the pressure?
No.
The weight of the refrigerant, you'd be able to tell how much was in it versus how much you got put in.
Still, but why can't we use a bathroom scale? Why shouldn't we use a bathroom scale? It has a special scale.
Because it's not accurate.
It's not as accurate. The bathroom scale gives you two digits. And what are we? The bathroom scale is to measure human body, which is between 50 and 300 or 400. So the range is very big. What is the? How much? How many ounces is in a? Is in a cylinder? 500 ounces? 30 pounds?
Yeah,
30 pounds. 30 pounds times 12, that's 3 times 12. Around 360. So that's not that much. 1060 ounces. So it's not that much. So you want something that's more accurate to at least half an ounce. So accuracy is an issue. So when we do the charging, we carefully monitor the evaporator, superheat, condenser subcooling, and operating pressure compressor amperage. Why do we have to monitor the amperage, the compressor amperage? So let's talk about them one at a time. Carefully monitor the evaporator superheat, make sure it does not exceed what it's supposed to be, condenser subcooling, operating pressure, so you don't overload the system. And that's why we want to take out everything and put it back again, so we make sure we do not overpressurize the system. If you overpressurize the system, that means not going to work properly, and it might damage the compressor. The compressor is the most expensive part of the entire air conditioning system. So, especially the small ones, like for the mini splits, they are very, very sensitive, and you don't want to overload them with refrigerant. The compressor amperage, what is the point about monitoring the amperage while you're taking the, while you're evacuating and putting some in?
Well, if it's over amping, it's working hard for a reason.
Yeah.
So it might be bad.
It might be stuck. Maybe there's not enough oil. it's not turning correctly, and you want to monitor that. As soon as you feel that there's a lot of amperage, you might want to turn off the compressor and double check your pressure and gauges. And again, compressors have a lot of small little seals between the cylinders, so you don't want to break any of these. Similarly to the your car engine again. If you overload the engine, if you redline the engine the whole time, probably there's a big possibility you break one of the ring seals, which are sealing the engine and getting rid of all the combustion in it. So vapor refrigerant charging, that's what we charge with the cylinder valve coming up, and that's when you get the vapor port, and that's happens during the low pressure. So low pressure, is that the big or small line? The big is the blue, and that's also the low pressure line. And it's what color is it? Low pressure?
Low pressure, what color?
Yeah.
Blue.
And it's usually, if you look at the pipe, it's bigger. So a bigger pipe, blue color, and that's vapor. That's when you do the charging through the with vapor. So vapor can be added to the low pressure side of the system while it's operating. Of course, you always have to turn it on, otherwise it's not going to have any added pressure to it. The cylinder may need to be warmed to build up pressure to charge the system, especially if it's not completely full. Do you understand why? So this pressure, this is liquid at room temperature, and if you have a little bit only left and you want it to come out and build up pressure, you might have to warm it up for it to start to take all the vapor out of it. The opposite happens when you're trying to collect refrigerant. You want to put some ice around it so it's cold, so all the vapor will turn into liquid. So it's liquefied gas. So you know what LPG is? When they say LPG and LNG? So LPG is liquefied petroleum gas, and LNG is liquefied natural gas. The way how you liquefy it is by pressure and temperature. So adding a little bit of pressure will liquefy it. If you have any of those butane gases, and if you look through it, the gas is liquid, right? And it's not a lot of pressure. Just a little bit of pressure. So probably when they try to fill it up quickly, without adding a lot of pressure, they cool them down, they draw the gas in, and it's in liquid form at room temperature. And did you notice if you have a butane lighter and it's too cold outside, probably wouldn't light properly. So you hold it in your hand, it warms up, and it lights easier. It becomes more vapor. So it's the same concept. So we have to warm up the cylinder to build up pressure and charge the system. Do I need to explain this or is it safe? Never use a torch or a fire to warm the cylinder. Warm water will be enough to warm the cylinder. So, again, always remember that you're dealing with refrigerant, and refrigerant is flammable. So you don't want to have any sparks or fire near it. So cylinder temperature and pressure. This is our refrigerant. Temperature, and we're trying, since we are evacuating from the top, we're going through the low pressure valve, and as the compressor is adding pressure, you see those little two valves here, this will open in the way down, and it will suck in vapor and push in high pressure. So this is low pressure and high pressure, and this will be the discharge. So here we have suction, and here we have discharge. And this is our manifold. Imagine, so is this a front seat or back seat?
That would be front seat.
Front seat. So when they say back seat, you'll hear that term a lot. Back seat is in the seat, sitting where it's supposed to, and it's closing. This is front seat, it's not in the seat. So if it's front seat, this line is open, and it's what we have for the manifold. And we have the common coming here, and this room, this chamber, is the common between the two lines. So you want to have this open for you to get through the service valve, you get the vapor all the way into the system. This is through the vapor line, and the other way to do is doing the with the liquid line. If I want to charge from the suction line, you put your gauge, the suction line in the discharge line, and it's high pressure, but you close the blue line up in the hot line, and that will be liquid. However, you have to have the cylinder upside down, because again, this is vapor and this is liquid here. That's what we. Let me draw a better cylinder here.
So for hot, there's no way to find out how much refrigerant is in the system.
It's really difficult, yeah. Before, it's really difficult.
Taking it out?
Yeah. You don't know what's in there, how much is in there. And they always say, when in doubt, you have to just pull it all out. And I asked actually for like big ACs, if they have indicator of their flow. It's really difficult. You can tell by the pressure and the subcooling, but you don't know exactly how many houses is there. You can add a little bit until it meets up, but if you feel like it's really hard to estimate, especially if there's a lot of lines, take everything out, put new refrigerant in, and recycle the old one. I was asking actually Tom Therrien about old ACs, if they had an indication. And some of them, they might. With the new technology now, they can interpret, based on the pressure and temperature, how much is in there. But, because we can tell, if you know the composition of the refrigerant, and you know the temperature, and you know the pressure, you can know the volume. And if you know the volume, and you know the molecular weight, you can calculate how many ounces is there. But I'm sure in some sophisticated system, probably they have this technology. And they tell you how much weight is in there, how much you need to add. Okay, so liquid charging. When you charge a system using liquid, you can do it through the liquid line. It's faster than vapor charging because again, you add liquid, more quantity. The low pressure control may need to be bypassed during the charging process. So you will not put any liquid coming into the compressor. The compressor does not lack liquid. So if you might need to bypass this section completely. Otherwise, you might introduce liquid into the compressor and that will break it. Remember this, the compressor does not like to have any liquid. Compressor compresses gas. So, and even coming out is compressed gas, not liquid, then it becomes liquefied. So make sure you have only gas coming through. Some tips here. Liquid refrigerant can be charged into a low side of the system if the refrigerant has first been vaporized. Low side. Low side means, I'm gonna write it down so we can remember. It's called low. Low side also means low pressure. Also mean big. Blue color. It's also bigger. Pipe. So this is all the same thing. Low pressure, bigger pipe, it's vapor line, and also a bigger pipe. And they make it sometimes more distinctive by having different size connector. The EPA now require you also to have low discharge connection. Is that what it's called? No, low loss. Low loss. What does that mean? That means the tubes has a valve at the end of them. So that you close the valve before you connect it. And you'll have some refrigerant inside the line. And I'll do the high side over here.
The low side's usually insulated too.
That's correct. put it down. Has insulation. So it is high pressure. Liquid. Also, little pipe. So liquid LL, liquid, little pipe, also has no insulation. Also it's hot. So this is how we have charged system, adding liquid. This is the manifold. Let me bring the manifold. It makes things easier to look at it. Let me just pause a little bit and bring the manifold.